Okay, I'm going to start the session now. So let the other participants keep joining. So good evening, everyone. My name is Sandesh Pangerkar. I am the person who actually started this LinkedIn group called MEQSA, Middle East Quantity Surveyors Association. So the purpose of this group I have shared previously. Basically, there are two purposes. One is the primary purpose, what I call, is to help the RICS APC candidates so that they can prepare for their competencies mainly. And the secondary purposes include a number of things which need your participations as well. For example, if somebody is looking for a job, and if you are aware of any vacancy, you can post that in the group. You can also try to help other candidates if you are a RICS qualified assessor or RICS qualified counselor, then you can try to help other candidates, or you can try to find other candidates a counselor. You can also update some of the latest RICS publications or anything which you find professionally, something to be shared on the group, you can share. So the secondary purposes of the groups are something which you need to share. Okay, it's not just only me and my team is going to do. It's about everybody else. But the primary purpose, we will be taking care of that, which is basically to help the RICS APC candidates in their competencies, both mandatory and the technical competencies. Now, those of you who are not aware of what is RICS, what is APC, because I see a number of candidates ask me a question, what is all this about? So I'm going to covering even the basics of what is RICS and what is APC in the current session. So some of you might be a bit in advanced stage who might be knowing all this, but just bear for the other candidates, just bear with me because I'll be explaining some basic terms. Okay, so these are the purposes of the group, but make sure when you are posting something on the group, you keep the contents professional and relevant to the industry we are in, the construction industry mainly, and professional. So don't post that I have a house to rent or I have something to sell from my house. Don't post those kind of contents, okay? So assuming that you are still okay and you are listening to me and you can clearly hear me, I'm going ahead with the presentation. So let's not waste any more time. So today's topic is introduction to RICS APC process. Now, what is RICS? RICS stands for the Royal Institution of Chartered Surveyors. It's an institution which was established originally in UK, but now it is worldwide. So we can say it's a global body. It serves a number of purposes, but one of the purposes of RICS is which is something must be sort of relevant to all of you because most of you want to become an RICS member. And one of that purpose is RICS advances the highest professional, highest technical and ethical standards in the professional people like us and like you who want to become a member of RICS. And these standards are recognized worldwide. RICS has its status, so that is recognized worldwide. And that's why we normally go for RICS qualification. Now, can you talk? I want to keep this session a bit of interactive, but not everybody can speak. So what we are going to use is the chat section of this particular presentation. So in the chat, can some of you or whosoever wants to do that, type why you want to become a member of RICS, why you want to become MRICS. Can you type in the chat box, please? I'm observing the comments, so please type. Yes, a number of responses we have received. Some very good responses to be recognized as an international professional for global relevance, for up-to-date knowledge, enhance my career growth. So this is important. This background is important before we start actually the introduction to the RICS. Because if you don't know, then why you want to become RICS, obviously you should know everything about your career sort of aspirations. Otherwise, there is no point. Just because everybody is becoming RICS, I want to become RICS, that couldn't probably be a good an answer. So if you ask me personally, Is RICS worth of it? Then my answer is yes, clearly it is worth of it. Because I personally, 10 years before, a decade before, I was in Davis Langdon. And my promotion from a QS to senior QS was only for the reason mentioned that I became a senior QS only for becoming a MRICS. That was mentioned by my senior management. Because I became MRICS, I was having other qualities, but MRICS was required for them to promote me. So career growth is one of the definitely one of the aspect where people want to become a MRICS. So to fill the gap in the experience and latest technology, that's one of the answers given by somebody. Okay, so a number of purposes are there. So without wasting any more time, let's now start today's presentation. So this is my profile, a brief profile. Some of you might know me. Those who don't know me, I have done my MBA from UK, from University College of Estate Management. And then I have a number of fellow qualifications. I'm fellow of RICS, also fellow of Chartered Management Institute and a number of other institute. I'm also a member of Chartered Institute of Arbitrator and Chartered Institute of Building. I'm RICS APC Chairman and Assessor and also RICS Accredited Civil Commercial Mediator. Currently, I'm Director in David Adamson Group for their Indian business operations, but I'm based in Qatar and leading a commercial management on one of the multi-billion project for one of a reputed client in Qatar. And also I'm helping people my client basically in one of the arbitration which is going on in London. That's a brief profile of mine. So today we are going to cover the RICS APC journey and submission and assessment requirement. And then we will ask you questions. If I can answer those questions, I'll try to answer those questions. In RICS APC journey, we'll see eligibility requirements, how to become a member of RICS through the APC route, what are the sector pathways, how RICS assess your competency skills, what are the competency levels, what is meant by competency which are mandatory and what is meant by competency which are technical. And then in submission and assessment, we will see what is case study, summary of experience, RICS online ethics course, CPD record, 60-minute assessment interview, and then I will tell you about further guides and support from RICS, which is available. And then we'll end up with the question and answer session. So RICS APC journey. Anybody, what is meant by APC? Does anybody know what is meant by APC? Comments, please. You can type the comments if you know the answer. Right, assessment of professional competence, as rightly said, because sometimes people have different understanding of what APC means. Assessment of professional competence. Whose professional competence? It's yours who want to become MRICS. And who is going to assess that? It's the RICS assessors who are going to assess that. Assessors like me and others who are in the market. So there are two main types of the RICS qualifications, except the senior level qualifications like FRICS. The entry level qualifications, basically there are two, Associate RICS and Chartered RICS. The Chartered RICS is also known as MRICS or Member of RICS. They are all same. Associate RICS is the entry level RICS qualification through which then you can slowly progress to the full chartered status. Normally people won't go for this. People would directly go for chartered status or what we call as MRICS. So what I suggest is we will concentrate on the MRICS because most of you want to become MRICS, a full member of RICS or a chartered surveyor. So let's have a look. These are the eligibility requirements for the APC route. When I say APC or assessment of professional competence, please do remember that APC is one way. There are other ways also, but APC is the most favorable and most sort of famous route. And most people go through this route. When I say other route, for example, there is senior professional route, or sometimes you can have a membership of other organization, which RICS recognize as a parallel organization. Now, these two are seldomly used, and most of you are here for the APC route, the APC journey, assessment of professional competence. So we are again going to concentrate on the APC route, assessment of professional competence. But please be aware there are other routes as well, like senior professional route. Now, through APC route, all of you can see the table. ATC stands for assessment of technical competence. There was some question. So assessment of professional competence, there are these four, you can see the table. There are four basically ways you can do it. Now, some of you might have an RICS accredited degree. Some of you may not have an RICS accredited degree. Those who have RICS accredited degree, there can be three ways they can do it depending upon which slot it fits in. Now, let's say if you have an RICS accredited degree and you are a fresh pass out from an RICS accredited degree college, you don't have any experience. In that case, what RICS suggests is you need to go through a structured training of 24 months or 2 years. And then you need to also gain CPD, continuing professional development hours of 96. I'll explain this CPD structured training a bit more in detail later on. So you need to have 24 months, 2 years structured training and 96 hours of CPD if you are a fresh pass out with an RICS accredited degree. Now, what is RICS accredited degree? RICS accredited degree is something which is recognized by RICS. Now, for example, some people do BSc quantity surveying full course through RICS accredited college, such as College of Estate Management, for example. In that case, it's an RICS accredited degree. Okay, they don't need to do anything else. They if they are passing out, then they just need 24 months structured training and 96 hours CPD. So if you are from that slot, then you select that particular path or that particular route. Now there could be some people who gained the RICS accredited degree few years before, and let's say for now they have 5 years experience, 5 years or more. Then they just need to do structured training of 12 months only or 1 year only, and the CPD will be 48 hours required for them. Those who have experience up to 10 years or minimum 10 years experience, they don't need to do any structured training. They just need 48 hours CPD. So this is for the RICS accredited degree. Now, most of us come from a background, at least I come from a background, I know most of the professionals come from a background where they don't have RICS accredited degree. They may have an engineering degree, for example, from their college, which from their nationality, wherever they are from the country. That degree most probably is not going to be an RICS accredited degree. And it's mostly engineering degree, let's say, for example. So in that case, that engineering degree is not recognized by RICS, but you need to always check with the RICS whether your particular degree is an RICS accredited degree or not. But generally, the engineering degrees are not recognized by the RICS for what we are talking about. In that case, you have the fourth in the table, the fourth or the last column. You can see there is bachelor degree or higher if you have. Then what you need to have is relevant experience of 5 years. Now, when we say 5 years, at least one year of that should be after your degree completion. So if you have completed a degree, 1 year should be after. The other 4 years can be before the degree, the experience. So they don't need to have any structured training, and they just need to do a CPD of 48 hours. Bachelor degree or higher. Higher means anything higher than degree. You can have a masterate. Some people say a master's degree. So minimum requirement is bachelor degree. Okay, so you need to have a degree. And then if you have 5 years experience, professional experience, and then that year should be after the degree. You don't need to do any structured training. You just need 48 hours CPD. Now, most of the people generally fall through, especially the people who are coming from India, they fall through sort of, they go for this route. The only thing is this route also needs a preliminary review by RICS. So your submission will go through a preliminary review by RICS. So this is the fourth sort of route and where most of the people fall. But there may be people here in this webinar today who have RICS accredited degree. So those will see whether they will fit into the first sort of column or second column or third column. And depending on that, they will choose. If there is any question, the best thing to do is to write to your local RICS. And generally they will ask you to send your CV, and then probably they will also send a template where you need to put your CV in that template. And then RICS will tell you whether you will fit in one of these four categories and where exactly you fit in. So RICS is obviously the best body to suggest where you fit in, but you can initially gauge where you are exactly. So those who really don't know anything about RICS, for them, this was sort of a bit of introduction that there are these different routes. Some people already may know about these routes because they already have sort of started their journey, the APC journey. But these are the basic four routes which are mentioned. And these are mainly for the Middle East candidates, because the group is created for Middle East candidates. But maybe there is a possibility that the requirements are same throughout other countries. But I'm sure that this is for Middle East candidates, because this is coming from a RICS published sort of document which talks about Middle East candidates. So definitely for Middle East candidates, these are the four routes if you want to go through the APC, Assessment of Professional Competence route. So you need to decide whether you fit in first or second or third or fourth. Okay. One more thing about this bachelor degree or higher, you also can have a membership of an RICS approved professional body if you don't have a bachelor degree. But again, that is something, as I said, that is already you are a member of some other professional body, and then RICS will consider your experience, etc. So best way is to write to RICS and ask them that this is my CV, where I am fitting in to start my APC journey. Now, some of you, if you are really from the senior professional route, then it's not here. APC is not the senior professional route. Senior professional route is a separate route altogether. And there are also parallel membership of some other organization where you can get a direct membership of RICS. But that is something which we are not discussing here. We are concentrating here on the APC route, assessment of professional competence to become a member of RICS, MRICS. We are not concentrating on associate RICS. Okay, so let's move to the next slide. It seems that the slides are stuck here. Okay. So the next slide is sector pathways. Now, what is sector pathway? Sector pathway basically is a specific field where you are working. So what RICS says, you are assessed on your sector specific skills, knowledge, and experience. So you have to select the sector pathway, which is mostly linked to your experience, area of expertise. For example, just for as an example I have given here, if you want to be an associate RICS, then there are 13 sector pathways given by RICS. And if you want to become an MRICS or a chartered surveyor, there are 22 sector pathways available. As an example, there is commercial real estate, environmental surveying, facilities management, project management, quantity surveying, construction, valuation, etc. There are total 22 sector pathways. So it will depend upon, let's say you are working in a project management firm, and all your experience till now is all related to project management, then you will see, you will select the project management as the pathway. Then you don't need to select any other pathway, because that is the one which suits you for your sector specific skills, knowledge, and experience. So that's the one you should select. Sector pathway is something that you should select. You can take guidance from RICS, but it is something, a decision that you should make. Where exactly I am fitting in? Where is my experience? Are you in commercial real estate, dealing with commercial real estate? Are you a quantity surveying in the construction field? Are you doing valuations? So it depends upon that. Are you an environmental surveyor? So depending upon your areas of expertise, your knowledge, where you are working, you will select the sector pathway. So there is a guide for the sector pathway which is available, and I will be publishing some of these guides on the LinkedIn group which we have, on the MEQSA group. But you need to select where exactly you are working, and based on that, you can say that this is my sector pathway, this is where I want to do my MRICS, or through this pathway, I want to do my MRICS. Now, what I did is, when number of members joined in the MEQSA group, I just did a quick random check and then did some statistic that where are people coming from. Most of the people I observed, they were coming from QS and construction. QS stands for quantity surveying. Quantity surveying and construction background. So what we are going to do is, we are going to concentrate mostly on the quantity surveying and construction background as far as the technical competencies are concerned. What is technical competency? We'll come to it in about few minutes time. Now, how RICS assess your competency skills? So as I mentioned, there are different sector pathways. For each sector pathway, they will be assessing your skills against specific competencies. So depending upon which sector pathway you have chosen, and depending whether you want to become a MRICS or associate RICS, there are different competencies at different levels. What are these different competencies? There are three types of competencies. Something is called as mandatory competency, core competency, and optional competency. Mandatory, the dictionary meaning word of the mandatory is that it's mandatory, compulsory or common to all pathways. So whether you are from a project management pathway, whether you are from a QS and construction pathway, or whether you are from any different pathway, the mandatory competencies are common to all pathways. As I mentioned, that we will be taking free sessions for the competencies. For mandatory competencies, it will be useful even if you are not from a QS and construction pathway. Even if you are from a different pathway, the mandatory competencies will be covered here. As far as the technical competencies are concerned, what are technical competencies? Technical competencies are those very specific to your specific pathways. So that we will be covering only for QS and construction pathway, because most of the candidates are from QS and construction background. Unfortunately, for everybody, we won't be able to cover because there are so many pathways. So QS and construction is something we have chosen as the pathway where we will be taking the technical competencies for that through the subsequent sessions. Now, in technical competencies, there are two ways. One is core competencies and another one is optional competencies. What is core? Core competencies, you definitely have to do all of them. Okay, they are core to your technical skills, your main technical skills. And optional, the name is basically suggesting that RICS gives a number of options from which you can select any two competencies. Now, as I said, QS and construction pathway, so I'll be concentrating on that pathway. Before coming to QS and construction, we need to understand the levels of competency. What is meant by levels of competency? So there are three different levels. The competency can be achieved at level 1, level 2, and level 3. Now, how the level will be decided? Again, which pathway you are selecting and what you want to become, whether you want to become an associate RICS or whether you want to become an MRICS, depending on that, the levels will be decided. And those will be decided by the RICS that you need to achieve these levels if you want to become an MRICS and you are in, let's say, XYZ pathway. So understanding the levels, what level 1 means? Level 1 means you have knowledge and understanding of that subject. You know the subject. You have read about it. You have an understanding what is meant by that particular subject or that particular concept. Level 2. Level 2 is application of knowledge, that you have actually applied that knowledge somewhere in the practice. So you can explain that with some examples that I did this in my XYZ project when I was doing this. And what is level 3? Level is the reasoned advice, which is the depth and synthesis of the knowledge. So you have very in-depth knowledge of that particular competency or that particular subject. That's level 3. So these are the three levels. Not all competencies RICS wants you to achieve at level 3. There are some competencies they need you to achieve only at level 1. For example, accounting principle and procedures is one of the competencies in mandatory, which they don't expect surveyors, quantity surveyors, for example, to know everything about accounting principles and procedures. So that competency they want you to achieve only at level 1. But the other competencies, which are core competencies for that particular pathway, the RICS want you to have the knowledge, understanding, application of knowledge, and also you should be able to give reasoned advice to your client. So in that case, they want you to have that particular competency achieved at level 3. So this is the difference between level 1, 2, 3. Level 1 is knowledge. Level 2 is application of knowledge. You have to demonstrate that you have applied or you can apply that knowledge. And level 3 is you can give a reasoned advice to your client, which explains that, which probably will tell them that yes, you definitely know about this. You have an in-depth knowledge about this competency and you can synthesize your knowledge. You can analyze the information. So these are the three levels of competencies. Now, what are mandatory competencies? If you remember, I mentioned before mandatory competencies. Mandatory means compulsory, means common to all pathways. Depending upon which pathway, no, it's all pathways. Whether you are from a project management pathway or whether you are from a QS construction pathway, all these competencies will be there. Now you can see the list on the screen. There are total 14 competencies, but the three of them, last three of them, 12th, 13th and 14th has a star. And the star says these are for senior professional candidates only. So these are not for all candidates. And we are not discussing here senior professional route. So actually there are only 11 mandatory competencies which you need to achieve at different levels as per RICS. Everybody, whether you are from QS and construction pathway or any other pathway. So the 11 competencies, right from 1 to 11, they are the competencies. So I'll just read it for you. Ethics, rules of conduct and professionalism. Now this is one of the most important competency. This is something, if you fail in this competency, you really fail the interview, RICS interview. So this is something related to the RICS rules of conduct for members, for organizations, but mainly for members because you want to become a member. Then it talks about the ethical, five ethical principles of RICS, and it gives a lot of information about how RICS operates, what are their guidelines, etc. So this competency RICS wants everyone to achieve at level 3. So they should be very thorough in this competency. Then another competency is client care, which talks about how you take care of your client, how you handle client's money, for example. So this is covered in client care, which needs to be achieved at level 2. Then there is communication and negotiation. RICS expects everybody to be good in communication and negotiation. So you should have knowledge of communication and negotiation. What are the different strategies of negotiation, for example? And also you should be able to do it in practice. You should be able to speak up. So this competency they want you to achieve at level 2. Health and safety. Health and safety related to the construction. For example, if you go on a construction site, what do? You just go or you wear something called as PPE, personal protective equipment. So this is related to the health and safety standards in construction, which is related to your area. So if you are based in UAE, then it will be mostly based in UAE standards. If you are based in Qatar, it will be based in Qatar standards. So this is a competency RICS wants to achieve. Accounting principles and procedure, as I mentioned. This talks about how a company performance can be evaluated. What are the different accounting ratios, for example. So this is only at level 1 because we don't need to be expert in accounting principles and procedure. So this needs to be achieved only at level 1. Then there is something called as business planning, which talks about how the businesses are planned, what is the SWOT analysis, etc., etc. Again, they want this to be achieved at a minimum level. Conflict avoidance management and dispute resolution procedure. Now, what is conflict? And what is conflict avoidance? So if there is a conflict on the project, if there is a disagreement on the project, conflict is disagreement. If there is a disagreement on the project, what you do? Do you directly go to court? So court can be one option, but there are other alternatives to court, for example, which are called as alternative dispute resolution procedures, ADRs. So negotiation, mediation, conciliation, these are one of those things. So the basic knowledge of that, those procedures is covered in conflict avoidance management and dispute resolution procedure. Then there is a competency related to data management. How do you manage the data on the project? Different people have different system, like for example, Aconex some people use. And what are the basic principles behind data management? Why we want to manage the data? So that is covered at level 1 in data management. Then there is diversity, inclusion, and team working. You should be a member of a team. You should act as a teamwork. There is always a teamwork and you should act as a team member. So all those principles are covered in team working. Inclusive environments. Then there is sustainability, for example. Sustainable, so what is a sustainable building? So those principles are covered. Again, sustainability is only at level 1. So you need to just have the knowledge of sustainability. What is meant by sustainability, etc. So these are the 11 mandatory competencies. We will be covering these through our subsequent sessions because these are mandatory and common to all pathways. We'll be covering all of these. We won't be covering leadership, managing people and managing resources, which are specifically for the senior professional roles. But the other 11 competencies we'll be covering through our subsequent sessions. Now let's come to the technical competencies. Now, as I mentioned before, technical competencies are technical to the particular APC pathway they are relevant. So if you are from QS and construction, then these are the competencies. I have not mentioned the other pathway competencies because, as I mentioned before, I will be concentrating and the group will be concentrating on the QS and construction competencies, because we really cannot take all the competencies for all the pathways, unfortunately, because we are a group of a few professionals who are trying to help by having the free CPD or free webinars. So for QS and construction pathway, what are the technical competencies? They can be again divided into two groups: core competencies, all of the core competencies. As you can see, there are six core competencies here, and all of them you need to achieve for becoming MRICS. You need to achieve all of them at level three. So you should be able to give a reasoned advice. You should have depth and synthesis of knowledge. What are those? Commercial management of construction works, or design economics and cost planning. One of the two you can choose here. There is an option here, little. Then construction technology and environmental services, contract practice, procurement and tendering, project finance control and reporting, quantification and costing of construction works. Now those are from QS background, they will understand the meaning behind this. And we will be covering all of these in our subsequent sessions. Then there are optional competencies. Optional means RICS is giving you an option to choose any two of the given competencies at level two. So you should be able to practice those. You should have practical experience of those. What are these competencies? You have insurance, due diligence, commercial management of construction, or design economics of cost plan. Why it is appearing again here? It was in technical competency also. But if you have taken, let's say, commercial management of construction in the core competencies, then you still can take design economics and cost planning as optional competency. Or otherwise, if you have taken the design economics and cost planning as core competency, you can take commercial management of construction as an optional competency. Then there is conflict avoidance management dispute resolution procedure again, which was in mandatory competencies. Now here what happens in mandatory, you are only taking this at level one. If you want to take conflict avoidance management and dispute resolution as part of your optional competency, then you need to achieve this at level two. That's the difference. And similarly with the sustainability, you need to achieve at level two. So let's see if you have any questions so far. How can we get the recorded version afterwards? I will tell you that in a bit. Don't worry. So conflict avoidance and management and sustainability also same. Level one is in the mandatory, but if you want to do it again, if you think you are good in sustainability, if that is something you work for, then you can take it at level two as well, at optional competency. Then there is capital allowances, programming and planning, project feasibility analysis, contract administration, corporate recovery and insolvency risk management. Again, depending upon where your skills are, where you are operating, what you do in your day-to-day life, what is your previous experience, based on all of that, you can select which are the optional competencies you want to take out of these competencies. So you have a good choice, good number of options from which you can make a choice. Now let's move to the submission and assessment requirements of RICS. So that was the brief sort of overview of what RICS process is, what are the competencies, because some people do not know about these things. Okay, they don't know, like they are starting right from scratch. So submission and assessment requirements. The assessors, okay, before I actually go into depth of the submission and assessment requirements, a lot of people have a lot of misconception about RICS. You need to be very expert in everything. You need to be master of all. No, it's not like that. The RICS assessor are only trying to determine your general level or ability. They don't want you to be expert in accounting principles and procedures, because you are not a CA, you are not a chartered accountant, for example. So what they expect you to have the minimum level of competency which they have already specified. So minimum level of competency which they have specified for your specific pathway, that they want you to achieve, or as for mandatory competencies, the given levels, they want you to achieve those levels. They don't expect you to be an expert of every professional activity. Please remember that. So there is nothing to worry about it. Okay, it's more based on your experience and what pathway you are choosing. Okay, what they also want you to understand that once you become MRICS, you will represent the RICS properly. Okay, that you have the expected conduct expected from an RICS professional. You can do that. You have that sort of conduct. Okay, so they take a holistic view of your training, your experience, your final submissions, the final presentation you are making on the day, and the interview you are giving. Obviously, the interview carries a lot of weightage, but there is an also a holistic sort of assessment of all of these. There is nothing to worry about it, that this is something which you need to be expert for everything. Now let's go through the requirements of submission. One of the things everybody needs to do, irrespective of which pathway you are, you need to prepare a case study. So what is a case study? This is something which you need to do for 3,000 words. And the case study will be based on a project which is very recent. So recent means what? It should be in last 2 years. So if you are having your interview in December 2020, then from there backdated 2 years project, within that period you can take any project. Okay, so it should be very recent in 2 years, and you need to prepare a case study of 3,000 words. Now, what a typical case study would include? So I have given you some hint of what normally a case study would include. At the beginning of the case study, obviously after the first page, there will be confidentiality statement or declaration. Then there will be index or content list, which is normally for any report you would have a content list. Then you can explain the abbreviation, because a number of abbreviations people use. And apart from the general known abbreviation, sometimes if you're using abbreviation of very specific to your field, there is a chance that the assessors may not know what you are talking about, because they may be very technical abbreviations, which not everybody is aware of. So it is better to explain the abbreviations at the beginning so that people understand what you want to mean, what you mean by that. So DB can mean a distribution board, or DB can mean a decibel level, for example. So it's better to explain the abbreviations used in your report or the case study. Then you introduce, you have an introduction of approximately 500 words, and you introduce to the project and the case study. Then you have my approach, which will be your approach in this case. So what is your approach to the case study? Then what are your achievements? And then you will conclude the case study. You will have the relevant appendices, and a total word count needs to be mentioned at the end. This submission generally goes through a system called as Turnitin system, okay? So this Turnitin system can actually identify if you are copying from somebody. So you cannot just copy a case study from somebody. RICS will identify that. Now let's take the next thing. Summary of experience. Everybody also needs to do a summary of experience. What is summary of experience? I talked about the competencies, the technical competencies and the mandatory competencies. So what you need to do, you need to prepare a brief statement about each competency. For mandatory competency, the total word count given by RICS is 1,500 words. And for technical competencies, they have given a range, which ranges from 3,000 to 4,000 words. Now, what you write about these competencies, again, for level 1, level 2, and level 3, you write what is expected out of that level. So for level 1, for example, you can write how you gained the knowledge, okay, and how that knowledge is linked to any relevant CPD in your CPD record. Because level one is about knowledge and understanding. As an example, in 2005, while working in XYZ company, I gained the knowledge about ABC concept. So this can be a statement. Okay, like that, you need to write statements about each competency at level one. For level two, you need to provide a statement of the range of experience you gained, you have achieved. The real life example you need to give, that in this project, when I was working on this, I experienced this particular issue. And then you explain how the understanding of that competency helped you to solve that problem or address that problem. So this is at level two. At level 3, there is a detailed statement to be provided, which is an advice given to a client. Again, you need to include the real life examples where you have personally given the advice. Now, the word limit is not really set per competency. Okay, the word limit is given for mandatory competencies 1,500. So you can write little bit less about one competency, little bit more about another competency. But my suggestion will be that look at the competency and look at what level you need to achieve. Try to write more or less average number of words for each competency, for each level of the competency. So if mandatory competency, if there is one competency at level one, you are writing, let's say, 100 words, then another competency which is at level two, you will be expected to write level one 100 words and level two 100 words. There is no such guideline or no such specific rule given by RICS. The only rule by RICS is the total number of words for mandatory competencies should not exceed 1,500. In fact, they should be 1,500. And for technical competencies, they have given a range 3,000 to 4,000 words. Now, 1,500, will you get exactly 1,500 words? Okay. With practice, you can get there. Okay. Generally, a plus minus 10 words allowance is okay, but normally you should not exceed. You should limit to 1,500 words. Okay. Try to reach to 1,500 words. For technical competency, there is a good range given 3,000 to 4,000 words. So that is not an issue. There you can achieve that. Number of people are asking me whether a video will be shared of this. I mentioned in the beginning of the presentation that yes, we are recording this, and if everything goes well, the video will be available on YouTube. Link of the video will be shared on the website, the LinkedIn page of this group, Middle East Quantity Surveyor Association. And those of you who are in WhatsApp group, we will share the link in the WhatsApp group as well. So don't worry, we are recording. Hopefully everything goes well. So let's move to the next requirement. Also, RICS wants you to do an online ethics course. Now, I mentioned about RICS ethics previously. There are 5 ethical standards which RICS wants the members to follow. What are these 5 ethical standards? Act with integrity. Always provide a high standard of service. Act in a way that promotes trust in the profession. Treat others with respect and take responsibility. So I've arranged them 3 A's and 2 T's, you can see. Act with integrity, always provide a high standard of service. Act in a way that promotes trust in the profession. Treat others with respect and take responsibility. These are the 5 ethical standards which RICS wants you to demonstrate. But as part of the submission requirement also, they want you to do an online ethics course, which RICS will send you sort of the details, and you need to achieve that. There is something called as, there is a platform where you do all this, which I'll explain in a bit. So what is online ethics module? It's a module which basically takes you through the RICS ethical knowledge. Then it will put you in a dilemma. It will put you in a position whether you should do this or do that. It will test your understanding. This course you need to complete. Once completed, this course is valid for 12 months, for a year. So you should arrange in such a way that when your sort of final interview date is it, from that, within a 12 months period, you should do this online RICS ethics course. Also, as a member, you need to be abiding by the RICS rules of conduct for members. So there are certain rules of conducts, you need to be abiding by that. That we will cover when we actually talk about the conduct rules and ethics professional competence. So what you need to know for now is you need to do an RICS online ethics course as part of the final submission requirement. Then also you need to submit your CPD record. What is CPD stands? What CPD stands for? Can anybody comment? What CPD stands for? Yes, continuing professional development. Not just continue, it's continuing professional development. Some assessors might just check your understanding of the basic terms. Okay, that's why I'm asking this question. So CPD, continuing professional development, means what? You are continuing your professional development. And to do that, what you are doing, not just you are working, you are also doing, you are attending some lectures, you are updating your knowledge, you are keeping up to date with the current practices, your region, etc. So that is all CPD. Now RISS classifies CPD into two sort of parts. One is formal CPD and another is informal CPD. Now, what is formal CPD? Formal CPD, what is anything which you get through professional courses, through seminars, or through online events where you learn something. For example, this particular session which we are having. If you think you are learning something new, or even if you are learning, then you can record this as a formal CPD. So if this runs for 1.5 hours, then 1.5 hours is your formal CPD hours you have gained through this particular session. So the CPD, now some people are asking, do we need to add the CPD certificates? Actually, no, RISS doesn't ask you to add the CPD certificates, because some organizations give CPD certificates, some don't give. Sometimes you just learn through informal CPDs. For example, you do your private study, or you are doing an informal reading of some magazine, okay, or some informal on-the-job training you are having. So that comes into informal CPD. You don't need to have the CPD certificates. What you need to do, you need to declare yourself your CPD. You need to actually submit the CPD that on this day I did this, and through this I achieved this learning. This was the learning outcome of that particular reading, or that particular attending of that particular seminar or online event. Okay. If required, RISS can verify that by asking you some questions about it. Okay. Normally, it is better to mention your learning outcome, because that gives an indication exactly what you learn. So just saying that today I had that RISS APC introduction session is not probably going to enough. You need to say what you have learned through it. You can mention some of the points you have learned through the slides, for example. So this is what you need to mention. So there is formal CPD and there is informal CPD. And what RISS says that if the particular pathway you have chosen, let's say it asks for you to complete 48 hours of CPD, then minimum 50% of that, minimum 50% of that should be formal CPD. So if it is 48 hours total CPD requirement, then at least 24 hours should be formal. Today's CPD certificate, are we giving? I don't think we are giving any CPD certificates, but you can record this as a formal CPD. The RISS is aware of this. How old CPD record can be submitted? Again, the CPD record should be relevant and very current. So if you are appearing, I would suggest that it should be within a one, for every year, there should be 48 hours CPD. So if you need to have 48 hours CPD, then that should be from the last 1 year. If you need to have 96 hours CPD, depending upon which pathway and which route you have chosen, then that can be through 2 years. So for 1 year, take the equation as 1 year is equal to 48 hours CPD. So that much old the CPD can be. And on the final day, what you will have is the 60-minute or 1 hour assessment interview. Before, the interview used to be face-to-face. The candidate used to go, there were normally three RISS people. Two of them are called assessor, one is the chairman, he's also assessor, but he's chairing that particular panel. So there used to be panel, you are sitting in front of them and they are taking your interview, basically. Now, nowadays, because of the pandemic, they have changed it to what you call as video calling technology. The video calling technology, what to use, is an RISS approved technology. There is plenty of guide available on the RISS website about this particular technology. So they have the instruction on using the technology. The tutorial is there. There is a YouTube, there is a video available on the RISS website. If you sort of go through that, you will be aware of it. What will happen to you on the interview day in the current scenario? Probably they will go back to the normal scenario, maybe in future when everything is okay. But for now, they are only conducting video calling technology interview. So video interview, basically. So you'll be sitting at the comfort of your home, most probably. So what's the interview structure? As you can see on the slide, the interview structure is basically total 60 minutes. 10 minutes of that, the first 10 minutes is candidate's presentation on the case study. So you will present on your case study. So you will talk about the case study. You will have probably a presentation prepared. Some people prepare a presentation, some don't. generally it is advisable to prepare something and then you can present that to the panel for the first 10 minutes. Now the timing is very important. They will cut you at the 10th minute. If you are exceeding 10 minutes, generally they won't allow you. And if you are too early, 8 minute, 9 minute also probably is not good. You need to be sort of very accurate to 9.5 to 10 minutes. In that band, you need to just appear because they will obviously give sort of points to this, how good you are in timing, how is your time management. Then after the first 10 minutes presentation, they will ask you questions on what you presented and also what your case study is. So the 10 minutes will be on the presentation and what is your case study about. After that, there will be approximately half an hour session where generally there are three assessors. One, the middle one probably will be the chairman, he will be chairing, and there will be two assessors. The two assessors will be asking you questions for the 30 minutes period. And in that question, they can include technical competencies, they can include optional competencies, they can ask you about your summary of experience, they can ask you about CPD, okay? So they can ask you about anything in your submission in that half an hour. Generally, the questions are sort of rapid fire round because half an hour is very limited time to ask so many questions because the assessors have a job to sort of decide or to assess whether you have achieved that particular competency at that particular level or not. Then after that, there will be chairman's questioning time. So he will question again about, he can question, mostly he will question about rules of conduct and mandatory competencies, but he can question about the CPD and other technical matters as well. So that basically includes your 1 hour interview period. It's a bit of tense sort of situation for most of the candidates. Because the time management is important and it's important to sort of demonstrate your skills, knowledge at the appropriate level in that 1 hour, because you just get that 1 hour of what you know so far throughout your professional experience. So that's the last part of the assessment and submission. Now, what I have covered today is a very brief requirement of the RICS APC process. Now, if you want to know more about it, then there are guides available by RICS. For example, there is a candidate guide which for Middle East, they have recently sort of published it, sort of revised it, which is dated August 2020, which is the most sort of latest guide for candidates. So for APC candidate, there is a guide called Candidate Guide, and it is published in August 2020. For different pathways, there will be different guides. I have given here an example of quantity serving and construction pathway guide, which was published in August 2018, and it is still current. And then there is something called as ARC, Assessment Resource Center. It's an online tool through which you can sort of, you will submit everything in it. The assessors can see it and sort of that's the online tool to manage your entire APC journey. So there are guides available for that also, how to operate that. Those guides I have given here, two examples. For one is for preliminary review candidates and another is for the APC 12 months and 24 months structured training candidates. So these are the user guides available for the candidates. Now also RICS provides you support. One, as I mentioned, ARC, it's an online tool to manage your details, your CPD, your competency record. So these, the templates will be here where you have to fill in the details, okay, online details. And your how you prepare your assessment submission, there will be dates, there will be indications, there will be guides available here, okay. And also this ARC is something that you will use right from the starting until end of your journey in the RICS. So it's an online tool where once you register for RICS and you select a particular pathway, then obviously they will give you an access to the ARC, Assessment Resource Center. Then there is RICS Assessment LinkedIn group. Now, most of the people are not aware of this group. So once you are sort of on the journey of APC, to support you through your assessment, there are some people who share knowledge and experience, and that is this LinkedIn group. Here you can ask questions. Some people can provide advice if they know. People can access the supporting material in this group. Membership of this group is open to all current RICS candidates and also people like us who are RICS qualified professionals who are there to support the candidates. So this is not our group. This is RICS group created by RICS, and it's called RICS Assessment LinkedIn group. Now, if you have any questions, I have tried to answer most of the questions as they came through the chat box. But if you have any questions, then you can type in, because now is a question and discussion time. So let me just run through all the questions again if I have missed anything. By that time, you can think of anything you want to raise. Generally, the questions I have answered, which came through the chat box. Now, some people are asking me how to select a case study. Any advice, please? Now, case study will depend upon, actually, it is you who need to take that decision. The guides, basically, there doesn't need to be always a big challenge which came on the project. It can be a small challenge. What they are looking for, not how big or small the challenge was. What they are actually looking for is how you sort of interacted with that problem, interacted with the people associated with the problem, and how that demonstrates your skills in the particular pathway required. Okay, so it's not about how big or small the topic is. Sometimes I have seen the topic which are as small as there was a problem in the bill of quantities and how they went about it to resolve that problem. So there is no specific guideline as to which case study you should select. It should be something through which you should be able to demonstrate your skills, knowledge, experience, and specifically the competencies required for RICS. Now, somebody is asking me, presently I am working as an estimator. What type of case study I have to submit? As I mentioned, there is nothing specific, but if you are working as an estimator, and if you encounter a problem in doing estimation, then if you have a past experience where you have how you came across around that problem solution, then you should select that, because that is something you have actually have experience in. Now, some people try to do theoretical case studies. They actually have not worked on it, but they just want to sort of talk about it. So that is not advisable, because the case study is based on your experience. It's based on what you have gone through. So it's always best to choose a case study. In fact, it is always, you should choose a case study which is your own experience, how you resolve the problems, or sometimes you didn't resolve the problem. Sometimes the contractor, let's say, got terminated. You didn't resolve the problems, but still, if you can demonstrate how you made an attempt to resolve the problem, that is also enough. Not everything gets resolved. Then some other questions I'm taking. How I can prove my particular CPD to RICS panel? As I mentioned, you don't need to really prove it, but this question should not arise, because if you have really done a CPD, then you will be able to demonstrate when they ask you question in your interview, okay, or in your prelim submission, if they raise something, you will be able to demonstrate that. Because RICS is not asking for any CPD certificates. Please remember, all what they are asking you to state when you did it, how many hours you achieved, whether you consider that CPD as a formal CPD or as informal CPD, and what are the learning outcomes out of that CPD. So they will not be asking you to prove like that unless they really have a serious concern or doubt that whether you did it or not. But I don't know how they will arrive to that conclusion. okay? But you should never claim something which you have not done. If you have attended a webinar, mention you attended a webinar. If you have just learned through that webinar from somebody else, then you mention that I just read through the slides which I obtained from somewhere else and put it in informal CPD. So is there a template for writing the case study and the competencies? As I mentioned, that there is a specific way you write a case study. So that way is suggested by RICS. I am not suggesting that. That way is suggested by RICS. So that's the way, right, to sort of, there's no specific template as such, but that is the way how you can write. And competencies, RICS will be giving boxes in which you can sort of fill in what you achieve, level one, level two, level three. So that is only sort of the format. There is no any particular detail format how you should do it. Okay, what I will do is I will upload a typical submission of a candidate. I think that is available on the RICS website, so there should not be any problem in sort of disclosing to you guys. So I will try to upload that on the website. The website, when I say website, I mean the MEQSA LinkedIn page. So that probably can give you a guide. Please remember, don't copy. It's not for copying purposes. It's only for the purpose of your understanding how to do it. Then we have a few more questions. My current organization, which I work, does not have any MRICS in it. Will it be obstacle towards me trying to get the MRICS? See, MRICS is not because your organization wants or doesn't want. In my case, I got sort of promotion because of MRICS, but I am not suggesting that's the only thing that you should always get a promotion because of MRICS. So that cannot be only driving force. Okay, you will be recognized well, maybe not in the current organization, maybe other organization will recognize you. For example, whenever I see the recruitment ads in Qatar, most of the clients here specify that the candidate should be a chartered surveyor, which means they are expecting the candidate to be a MRICS. So why don't you consider that as an advantage, that a wider market will be open to you when you become MRICS. So you look it from that perspective. Whether your current organization will consider it as an obstacle, not sure. That depends upon the organization. But as long as you are working towards MRICS without affecting the work, then that should not be a problem to any organization. So somebody saying thank you, okay. What should be the average word count for level 1, 2, and 3? I think I addressed this. There is no specific word count, but it is better to work on the average based on, as we said, for mandatory competencies, there is a specific limit. So you can work out backwards for each level, how many words it will come. Then tell me the difference between APC route and APC preliminary route. Actually, prelim is part of sort of, I would say, part of APC. It's not a different route. So in this particular case, you just need to make the prelim submission, which will be reviewed by RICS, and then they will say whether you can go ahead with that or not. That's basically the difference. Then there is a question. Do we need to cover two technical competencies in case study? Not really. I would say you need to cover as many competencies as possible, not only technical, also mandatory. As many competencies, because at the end of the case study, you can write through lessons, through the experience gained, you can write that you gained experience on so many competencies. As many possible as you should, because the case study also, that will help in presentation of your submission, that through your case study, you worked on so. But there is no such limit mentioned by RICS. But as long as you select a relevant case study, it will automatically cover most of the competencies. Can architect become MRICS? One of the questions. Yes, why not? because MRSS only stands for member of RICS. So you can actually, but for architects, obviously there are other bodies also who are operating and who give sort of their professional membership. So it will be your personal choice. But yes, I know there are some people who become member of RICS, but your pathway will be different. Your pathway won't be the QSM construction pathway. Your pathway will be different. It will be relevant to what you do as an architect. Yes, I said that there is no need to attach the CPT certificate to the submission for APC. If you have, you can attach, but there is no compulsory requirement that for every CPT you must have a certificate, because most of the CPT you will earn, which will be informal, you will not have certificate from anybody. Then there is a question, if I enroll in Bahrain after that, due to this pandemic, lost my job, then is it possible to submit my APC in my home country? Yes, it is possible. There are a number of candidates who are experiencing this. And as a first step, you should write to RICS and they will guide you. But I know there are many who have left from Qatar and they are completing their submissions from India, for example. Then there is a question, I'm working as a site engineer. So is it possible to enroll with this experience for RSS? Yes, it is possible. You need to select which particular, you have seen that table where exactly you fit in and depending on that. But you should have at least a graduation, because all of the requirements mention at least a graduation, whether it is from an RSS accredited degree or whether it is a general graduation from a non-accredited university. Then somebody is asking, he's from a client team, and whether appointing a QS consultancy firm, whether he can take that as a project for case study. Yes, why not? If you think that is an appropriate project through which you can demonstrate your skills, competencies, yes, you can. So there is no particular limit or there is no particular guideline what the case study should be. You should be able to demonstrate all your experience, the relevant experience in that particular period, and you should be able to demonstrate the achievement of competencies. That is important. Previously mandatory competency 10, why is 11? That is something you need to ask to RICS, because RICS decided to do that. They decided to include additional competencies. How much is the expected time to finish the competencies and case study? Are they the ones required for the preliminary review? Yes, the preliminary review submission will also have these requirements. The expected time, it depends actually, but I would say that to actually prepare the APC case study and prepare for the competency, on my personal experience, minimum 4 to 5 months are required. If you want to do a sort of quality job, then definitely minimum 4 to 5 months are required. But then the enrollment requirement, when you can appear for the final submission, when you can appear for the preliminary, then final submission and then final interview, there are certain specific dates for each region. So you need to observe those dates. They are on the RICS website. And then you need to meet those dates. So you may actually need more than 6 months really to start from. Yes, in 12-month structured route, yes, you need to update the diaries regularly. Somebody's asking, when I change my company and profession, what will happen to APC? Now he's changing his company, we don't know which company. Company change doesn't really matter. But profession, yes, it may affect. For example, if you are a QS and if you change to planning engineer, then there is slight difference, okay, in the APC pathway. But if you change from QS to estimator, then I would probably still say you are still okay, good to go for QS and construction pathway. So that would be the difference. Is there any validity period for the CPD record? Yeah, as I mentioned, the CPD record also should be current. So for every 1 year, you can consider that 48 hours. So for 2 years, 96 hours should be relevant, or the time period for that. So if you have been asked to do only 48 hours of CPD as per RICS, and if you are saying that the one of the CPD I did 5 years before, then that is not going to be accepted. It should be within 1 year period. Is it mandatory to do case study if someone having more than 10 years experience, QS degree and working as a senior QS? The answer is yes. The requirements I mentioned are for all APC candidates. Okay. So whether you have a RSS accredited degree or not, and what is your experience doesn't matter. It is mandatory unless there are senior professional routes or there are other parallel organization membership. If you have, then the situation might be different. But otherwise, what I explained is for everyone. Do we have any syllabus? Yes, there is. So one of the guides I mentioned is a guide about the particular pathway. That particular pathway guide, QS and construction pathway guide, is for the candidates who want to do the APC through the QS and construction pathway. So they explain what is expected out of that competency. So when they say technical competency, contract practice, so what do they expect you should know out of contract practice? So it's always good to thoroughly read the guide before you sort of start anything. Can I change my counselor at any time? Yes, you can. There is no specific guideline about it that you cannot change the counselor. But I would imagine that you will have a reasonable sort of, you will have a valid reason to change the counselor. Maybe he is not giving you time or something like that. Or you have changed from one geographical location, you have moved to another geographical location. But yes, you can change your counselor. Try not to change as far as possible, but if there is no real alternative, so there is nothing else you can do, you can change it. But to change the counselor, you need to find a new counselor. Either you need to find or you need to contact RSS. Generally, they would ask first you to find a new counselor. In which states I can say I am RSS APC candidate? In which stage you mean probably? In which stage you can say? Once you contact RICS, they will ask for your CV. Once you give them CV and once they confirm that yes, you are eligible to go through the APC pathway route, then you can say you are an RICS APC candidate. Online courses are accepted as CPD? Yes, they are accepted as CPD. And in current pandemic, definitely everybody will be accepting online courses. But in general also, online courses are accepted as CPD. How can I earn 48 hours formal training? As I mentioned, for formal training, there are a number of options that you can select, online training, seminars, etc. MSc in Heriot Watt University in Dubai as part-time, will this be accredited by RICS? Part-time means, I'm not sure, like what was your previous qualification, depending on that. Because some people just do the final year of MSc or the final year of PSc. So that is not the full RICS accredited course. So better you consult with RICS whether whatever you are doing is RICS accredited or not. Is there any panel interview for prelim submission? No. At the stage of prelim submission, you don't have any interview. That will be assessed by the assessors. But after that, once they give you go ahead, then you will have a final interview. Is there a list of accredited counselors on the RICS website? For Middle East region, I have not seen really, but I've seen a list for UK and other regions. Maybe they have not updated for Middle East regions. So my suggestion is to contact the local RICS. Part-time MSc is accredited by RICS. Yes. Fees and cost for MRICS, they keep on changing. So again, it depends upon which route you are going through. I would suggest you should see the RICS website. It mentions about the fees and cost. I have graduated BSc 2019, but I am having around 10 years of experience. If you have more than 10 years of experience, then you don't need to have any structural training or structural duration. The senior route, is there any senior level route for candidates who are having more than 20 years experience? The senior route is not really depending only upon your number of years of experience. It depends upon a number of other things. Again, best is to contact RICS for that, because they will assess whether you are eligible for the senior professional route. Because you should be also working at the senior level in the company, and you should be able, so you should be managing a number of people. You should be able to sort of take important decisions. There are a number of criteria behind this. How long to get appointment for interview once I have registered? Again, depending upon the part, depending on how you go. If you are in prelim submission, there is first stage that your prelim submission needs to be sort of approved by RICS. Then only you can go for interview. But I think the minimum time required is not less than 6 months. What if I'm involved in a conflict at a project and one of my colleagues has already submitted the same as his case study? Can I offer the same case study? No, I would say no, because it will go to the Turnitin system and it will sort of take it as a copy. Now, whether you submitted him, whether you were the sort of best person to submit it, that argument RICS will not get into. They will just consider it is a copy of another submission. I think most of the questions I have tried to answer, but if I have missed anything, then do let me know. Is RICS from MENA region is same as RICS from India? General principles will be the same, but those who are doing from India may have some specific region separate requirements. So I would suggest check with your local RICS. Yes, the prelims option is there. Do the RICS give feedback on case study and competencies written, or this is all after the final interview? Can it be rejected and asked for further refinement? You will not get a feedback from RICS on your case study and competencies, unless you are going for the sort of prelim submission, etc. So you will get the feedback at the end, but during the process, you have a counselor who is supposed to give you the feedback, and that is counselor's roles to give you the feedback, and then you can improve your submission. I have contacted RICS Qatar via email and via phone. They are not responding. Generally, they are good in responding. I'm not sure why they are not. Maybe because of the current situation, they are taking a bit of time. But I know Nadia, for example, in Qatar, she's good in responding generally. So if you still have any issues, then just write to me and I will just raise it to Nadia for a response to your email. Uh, 48 hours from the date of final submission, within a year. Yeah, then you can raise it to me. If you can send an email to me, I will approach Nadia. How do you find a counselor if your employer is not chartered? I'm sure you will have some local contacts or your social group through which, and I mentioned about the RICS assessment group on LinkedIn. There you can try that you are trying to find a counselor. And if you still don't get, then write to RICS. Yes, in experience, you can write undergraduate training as an experience. So we are almost about to come to the end of the time of this particular session. Now, I will try to sort of provide you link as soon as possible of the video. So if you are looking for the slides or if you are looking for some information, that should be covered through the video, hopefully. And if you have any more questions, please raise them on the LinkedIn group. Yes, RSS, the case study should be 2 years old. Currently, I'm following BSc in QS. If you are doing a full-time BSc in QS, then probably better to wait for it, and then you can go for a different route. But otherwise, you can start now also for registering with the RICS. Next section, we are going to now. This was really a session which was not initially planned, because we thought that we will start with the technical competencies. But then a number of candidates contacted me and some others in the group, and they were not really aware of the concept of APC, the concept of RICS. That's why I took the session. I know most of you, at least some of you, will find that all this we already know, but I had to take care of the other candidates who didn't know about this. So do write to me or do write on the LinkedIn group. How did you find this session, today's session? Did it help you? Did it not help you? If there are positive comments, that will help us to give more and more free CPDs, so that at least you will earn the CPDs. Because normally outside, people are charging for the CPDs, or if there are other institutions, normally they will have some sort of fees for the CPDs. So for initially, the reason I went through the initial slides and the reason I talked about the group is because, just to make everybody aware of the purpose of the group. Probably some people have thought that it was waste of time for first 5 minutes, but it wasn't really, because I had to ensure that people understand what is meant by MRICS, why they do MRICS, what is RICS, what is CPD, what is APC. This is very important. If you're going for something and if you're committing your time, you must know what are you committing your time for. Okay, so thanks a lot, and do write on the LinkedIn group, how did you find today's session? I'm going to end the session in a minute.